Well, we're in week four of talking about what it means to go deeper in our relationship with the Lord. And I have to tell you, last Sunday when we canceled church, I hate it. I absolutely hate it. And we don't hardly ever do it. I think maybe once in the last 17 years we have had to do that. Whenever they say no driving, only emergency vehicles, we feel like that's the way we've got to honor our government and do the right thing. And so we canceled, and I was sitting around home thinking, you know what, we're going to have to move on from the content of today by next week. And so thought, I'm going to just do a Facebook Live message right here from the kitchen table. And so I did that and heard some interesting stories from different people about watching online with their kids in bed that morning, watching while they were having breakfast, watching while they were driving down the road. I'm thinking the driver was only listening and then everybody else was maybe watching. But all kinds of ways that people tuned in last week. It was kind of an abbreviated version of Deeper Week 3. And it's on our website now. And I began that message by asking people to rate the relationship with God. What I wanted you to do was to just stop on a scale of 1 to 10 and think about how would you scale your relationship with God today, 1 being non-existent, 2 needs improvement, or say 5 needs improvement, so we jump it up, and then 10 was never been better. So you've got those 3 possibilities there, and then whatever's in between, how would you rate your relationship with God? Even if you didn't get a tune in, I want to invite you to think about that question this morning. How would you do it? How would you say you would measure your relationship with God today? Non-existent, needs improvement, never been better, somewhere in between. Now, I challenged everybody to think about what's it going to be like to move that relationship needle 1 notch. Just at least 1 notch. So if you're a 6 today, what would it take to make it a 7? Or if you're an 8, what would it take to make it a 9? That's what this series is all about, because we want to grow bigger in our faith in 2019. And as we've said, healthy relationships, we believe, are built on trust. And our hope is that everybody participating in this series is going to develop absolute confidence, absolute trust, and complete faith in God. What would that look like in your life? How would that change things for you? What would be different in your life if you had absolute confidence that there's a personal God who knows your name today and he knows everything there is to know about you? What would it be like if you really believe beyond any shadow of a doubt that God is willing to walk beside you and be actively involved in every aspect of your life? What would that look like for you? What if you were truly convinced that God meant it when he said that he would never leave you or forsake you? How would it affect your life if you truly believe that God is in control and that he's at work behind the scenes, even when you don't see how that's possible? See, God wants us to have trust in him on that level. And I think most of us, if we were honest, we'd say, you know what? I want to trust him more. I want to have bigger faith this year. And our lives would be so much easier and a lot more peaceful if we did that. But the problem is we struggle to get there, don't we? It's not all that easy. So the question is, what's the problem? And I'm convinced the problem can be summed up in 1 word. And that word is trust. That's what holds us back. That's what keeps us from getting there, because trust is the foundation of our relationship with God. And if you're taking notes, I'd encourage you to jot that down. Trust is the foundation of our relationship with God. For years, I thought the foundation of a relationship with God was all about obedience. That's kind of the way I'd been conditioned growing up. That's what I'd always heard. But have you ever thought about the difference between trust and obedience? Obedience is tangible, trust is not. And trust can be scary. In some ways, I actually think obedience is easier than trust. I need somebody to volunteer to help me out for just a minute. Kyle, would you do it? Dave, would you help me out? Come on up just for a second. I was going to get around and ask somebody to do this ahead of time, and I didn't get a chance. So, Dave, this is Dave Reeser, one of our small group leaders, and I appreciate you doing this. Would you mind just walking over and touching the keyboard and then come back to me? Okay, thank you. Give Dave a hand. He did an outstanding job, wouldn't you say? Okay, that was easy, wasn't it?
It was.
Got to ask you to do 1 more thing. Would you turn and face the screen, and would you just fall back, stick your arms out, and I want you to just fall back in my arms. Well, he's going to do it, isn't he?
I trust you.
Yeah, I appreciate that. I'm kidding you. Thank you. Yeah, he really did it. And but, you know, for a lot of people, we've got a great relationship. A lot of people might have found that difficult to do. And I was going to let it go as far as I could. I thought you would do it, and I do appreciate it. But, you know, obedience, that's easy, isn't it? Walk over, touch it, do whatever. You know, we can get our check mark. But when it comes to trusting, that's a whole different story. And the way you view every aspect of life is going to be different. Listen to me. The way that you view every aspect of life will be different when you have 100% confidence, faith, and trust in God. It's going to change everything. See, this level of faith will change the way you view money. It'll change the way you view morality. It'll change the way you handle ethics and relationships, the way you deal with tragedy, life, death, you name it. It affects everything. And so today we're going to begin addressing some very specific things God seems to consistently use to grow our faith. And we're going to be doing that over these next several weeks. And today we're just going to focus on one. And no matter where you are on that growth spectrum, on a scale of 1 to 10, these are some things that God can use to help our faith grow deeper. What we're going to talk about today is practical teaching. Lots of people have been exposed to the Bible. But a lot of people fail to understand, how does the Bible apply to my life today? What difference does it make in the way that I live from day to day? And, you know, they don't get it. So practical Bible teaching means teaching for a response. That's what we do here at The Point. We're looking for life change. I have found that people are far more interested today in what works than in what's true. And our focus here is on the truth of God's Word. And how does that truth make a difference in the lives that we're living, in the families that we have, in the work that we do, in the relationships that we're a part of? How does that faith make a difference in our day-to-day lives? See, we believe truth with next steps will grow our faith. It's important for us to know what to do with what we've learned. It's about putting knowledge into practice. In your notes, our faith grows deeper when we see the Bible as not just something to know, but something to do. The doing has to follow the knowing. And so our faith grows deeper when we see the Bible as not just something to know, but something to do. When you just read the Bible and memorize it and never apply it, there's a problem. It's a problem for several reasons. It's a problem because, see, people are educated way beyond their level of obedience. You probably know more than you do. And that's what I mean by that is we know more than we do. And there seems to be a high level of contentment with just having Bible knowledge today with people. What we know should make a difference in how we live. Would you agree with that? What we know should make a difference in how we live. And would your spiritual life look any different if you decided to truly apply and do everything you already know? Jesus certainly taught toward application, but, you know, not just to knowledge. Matthew chapter 5, verse 7 is the greatest message ever preached. If you don't realize it, those three chapters are one message that Jesus delivered to a crowd that had gathered. It is the most powerful and profound message ever. And the Sermon on the Mount was certainly not a message about just what to know. It was a message about what to do. It's like Jesus is saying, hey, if you want to have big faith in God, here's how you would act. This is what you would do. And then he speaks about the behaviors that would characterize the life of a person who has big faith in God. So he said something like this. He said, hey, if somebody asks you to go 1 mile, you go with them too. It's about what you do. He said, somebody offends you, what do? You forgive them. And by the way, adultery is a sin, but so is lust. What you do with your eyes and with your mind can be as sinful as what you do with your hands and your feet. And so when it comes to giving, be generous and give as much as you can. And Jesus is basically saying, this is how you live as a person of faith. If you really want to live a life of faith, this is what it's going to look like. And his entire message was about application. And make no mistake about it. This is not about gaining God's favor. This is not about doing some good things so that you can get to go to heaven. We know that works don't save us. That's not what it's about at all. This is about practical teaching. And Jesus was all about application. And I can prove it because when he gets to the message, the end of the message there in Matthew chapter 7, it's been a message three chapters long. He gets to the end of the message, and this is the way he ends it. It's what he had to say in Matthew 7:24. He said, "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and does what? Puts them into practice." Puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the wind blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. If you want there to be a difference in your life, if you want your faith to shine, if you want your faith in God to show up in your world, there are some things that you can do, some things you can put into practice. You could memorize every word that Jesus spoke, but if you don't do anything about what he said, what difference does it make? I mean, really, what difference will that make? On the other hand, your relationship with God will come alive when you begin to apply what you learn. When you begin to do something about what he said, the thing that's going to make life better is when you get serious about exercising your faith and being willing to apply what you know 24/7, 365. Because application changes everything. It really does. You believe all kinds of stuff, but until you do something about what you believe, it really doesn't change your life all that much. It may not change your life at all. But God shows up when you begin to apply what you know. Because when your faith intersects with God's faithfulness, meaning that we begin to do what we know, God will begin to honor and bless that obedience. As a matter of fact, that's when obedience becomes an act of faith. I do what God is calling me to do, not because it makes sense, not because somebody else did it, not because I think it will quote-unquote work, not because I think it'll make my life better. Why do I do it? I do it because he said to do it, and I trust him. I do it because he said to do it, and I have chosen to place my trust in him. And when you live like this, obedience, then rather than being a law keeper and all about, you know, getting your check marks and dotting the I's and crossing the T's, at that point, obedience becomes an expression of faith and trust and confidence in our Father in heaven. That's the difference. When you do this, God shows up in your life in a new way and in a deeper way. But it will not happen until you learn to apply and do what you learn from the Word of God. See, the goal of the Christian life is not to see how much information we can gather. The big question is, what are we going to do with all the information that we already have? What are we going to do with the information that we get that's new? What are we going to do with that? Every once in a while, I'll run onto people here at the church that talk about the fact that they have every message outline that we've ever offered here at the Point since they started attending. And I love to hear that. Some have a book at home or a folder or a file drawer, and every week they save that outline on their worship folder as a point of future reference, and I think that's an awesome thing to do. I'm glad to hear people do it, and in case you're not aware, now you can save those on the Point app. You can save it there. You can share it from there. But here's the potential hazard that I always want to bring up when somebody mentions that to me. You can listen to the message and you can save outlines for the rest of your life, but it won't mean a thing until you apply what you know. What are you going to do about it? Well, I've got this file drawer full of sermon outlines. Well, so what? What are you doing about what you know? I mean, I'm glad you save them. You can listen to those messages. You can save outlines for the rest of your life, but it won't mean a thing if that truth is not applied in your lives. Because those outlines can stay in the drawer, can't they? They can stay in a file folder. What I want to know is, what are you doing about what you've heard? Our goal around here is not to inspire you toward more theological knowledge. Not that theological knowledge is bad, but that's not our goal. Our goal is to inspire you to be the person God's calling you to be. And that'll only happen as you begin to do something about what you hear. As you begin to apply what you know. And, you know, being a consistent church attender has little value if you're never going to go out there and do something with the truth that you hear. And that is exactly how people can hang around the church for 30 or 40 years and still remain spiritually immature. They never grow up because they never apply the truth that they've heard. they're what I like to call Bible snobs. You know what a Bible snob is? It's somebody that has lots of knowledge, but they never do anything about it. Lots of head knowledge, no application. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm glad you're here today. I'm glad everybody's here today. I think it's good to be in church, but I don't think God is in heaven taking notes on attendance about who's here today. But I do believe this. I believe he's vitally concerned about what we do with what we hear, because obedience then becomes the key factor. You see, the builder Jesus told us about in our text, he did the right thing. He heard the word and he put it into practice. That's why his house didn't fall when the storm came. There's nothing wrong with acquiring information as long as you do something with the information that's been acquired. For information to matter, it has to be applied in our life. You have to put it into practice. And if you want your life to matter, you need to do what God says. Jesus continued on in Matthew 7:26. He said, "But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on the sand." I mean, let's face it, you can have 100% church attendance and be living like someone who has never walked in the door of a worship service and who doesn't even believe in God. I mean, there's a tremendous burden on me as your pastor, because I know application of what you hear is what's going to make the difference. In verse 27, he went on, he says, "The rain came down, the stream rose, the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash." When Jesus finished saying these things, the crowd was amazed at his teaching. The people were accustomed to the teachers pouring out more and more and more knowledge, just dumping the knowledge on them again and again and again. And then Jesus comes along and said, "Here's what to believe, and here's what to do with what you believe." It's like he's saying, this is what faith looks like in real life. And then he kind of fleshed it out for everybody. He fleshed it out for them. Faith means you forgive. Faith means you go the second mile. Faith means you look the other direction. Faith means you give generously. He just spelled it out. This is what faith looks like in the real world. Faith is the real game changer when it comes to this matter of obedience, because this is when obedience becomes an expression of my confidence in God. What I may know, it's not going to make much sense, you know, but because I have so much confidence and so much trust and so much faith in God, I decide I'm going to do what he says even when I don't understand. And when you listen to what he says and when you apply what you learn, it's like building your house on the rock. Get it? I mean, when you listen to what he says and when you apply what you learn, that's like building your house on the rock. Knowing the Bible's good, but I don't want to stop short of doing what it says. And this is why, as followers of Christ, we want to learn to think and act and live from a biblical perspective. See, surveys have shown that most Christians in contemporary culture, they don't even have a biblical worldview. That's what we see played out again and again. They don't see life from a biblical perspective. I'm talking about Bible-believing Christians, people that show up in church every Sunday. They don't even have a biblical worldview themselves. We saw evidence of this last week when the state of New York passed the Reproductive Health Act this very week. You need to understand something, folks, if you don't get this already. Culture is working very hard to reshape the way that we view the world and everything about it. Many professing Christians, they don't seem to have a biblical perspective any longer. They don't seem to have a biblical worldview any longer. They don't see the world from a godly point of view. And that is why there is such a slight distinction in the way the world thinks and the way many professing Christians live their lives. And this is not just a factor when it comes to the sanctity of human life. It applies to matters of morality and integrity and character and you name it. See, a Christian, you know, we need to realize that a Christian who has a proper understanding of the Word of God and the world, they'll realize how important it is not only to know what the Bible says, but to be willing to stand up and do what it says. Faith should make a difference in the way we live our daily lives. And my prayer is that every time you walk through the doors of this church, you will hear something that you can decide to do or put into practice every week. See, you may know a lot about God, you may know a lot about the Bible, but what difference is that going to make in how you live your life? What are you going to do with what you know? See, obedience stands at the intersection of my faith and God's faithfulness. And practical teaching is the catalyst to grow our faith up bigger than it's ever been before. We've said it a lot around here. Unapplied truth is like unapplied paint. It doesn't do anybody any good until it's applied. The value of paint is in the application. And it's really the truth with truth as well. You know, we can memorize scripture and know all the great stories about obedience, but if our knowledge doesn't move us toward application, then our faith is going to remain weak. In some ways, I would say even meaningless, pointless. When you come to church, though, what we try to do around here, it's like we try to open up a can of paint and stir it up and hand you the paint and hand you a brush. That's what we're trying to do every Sunday. We want to make it easy for you to apply truth as much as possible. And that way, when you walk out of here, it's time to start painting. It's time to start applying what you've heard. An application of truth should make a difference in the way you're living your life, at home and at work and at school and in the neighborhood and wherever you go. And if you don't apply what you know, that knowledge has little to no value to you spiritually. If you don't apply what you learn, Jesus said, not me, I didn't say this, Jesus said, if you don't apply what you learn, you're like a man or a woman who built their entire house on a foundation that will never stand up to the storm. And it may look good for a few days. That house may look good for a few weeks or a few months. It may even look good for a few years. It may look good standing looking at it from off in the distance. But mark my words, a storm is coming. A storm is coming. And it's going to test your foundation. You count on that. And everyone who hears these words, the words of Jesus, and puts them into practice, is like a wise man, or woman, or teenager, or single adult, or senior adult, or newlywed, or whoever, who built their house on a rock. Would you bow with me, please, as we pray? I want you to think about what we've said, and let's ask the Lord to speak to us. Father, would you give us the courage to place ourselves in settings where we're going to hear the hard stuff? And then would you give us the wisdom and the determination that we're going to go do something about it? I'm convinced that our act of faith will intersect with your faithfulness, and our lives will be changed as our faith grows to a new level that would have never been possible apart from taking that important step of obedience. So many unfortunate circumstances can be avoided if we'll just learn to consistently apply the teachings of your word to our daily lives, to our marriages, to our families, to our work, even in our relationship with you. Today could be a new day as we place our absolute confidence and trust and faith in Jesus Christ. And I pray for those that maybe have never taken that step, that today would be the day. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to propose to you three particular application questions. I'd invite you to jot these down. As you're thinking about what am I going to do with what I hear, three things. First of all, what does the text say? What does it say? What does it mean? What will I do? Those are the three basic questions you have to ask yourself when you hear practical teaching, when you hear biblical truth. What does it say? What does it mean? What will I do? I want you to hear what happened to a friend of mine when he began to apply God's truth in his life. Take a look.
No, I didn't grow up in church. I was exposed to church from friends and neighbors. There was no faith in my home growing up. There was a Bible. It sat on a table. It never was opened. About five or something, neighbors took us to church. Well, I grew up and I had a friend, Andrew, and he always went to church. So we're about fifth grade or something. One day we're in Sunday school and lady comes in asking us how we're all doing, and she asked if any of the kids want to accept Christ as their Savior. And Andrew pops up and he goes up to the front, and a couple other kids start popping up. And so I had a little bit of knowledge. I knew God was good. And so I popped up and went to the front and accepted Christ as my Savior. And ever since then, I know God had he's always had a hand on me, always. Growing up, I was athletic. I did well in school. And God gave me all those gifts. And I took God out of the picture and put him in the back seat. I was good at sports. I was good academically. It was me. And thinking that way, put God aside, everything I did came up short. It would always come to a point where I knew I was going to do great things, and it would just plummet from underneath me. I turned 20 and I realized I didn't have anything. With that acceptance of Jesus as my Savior when I was 5, I believe brought me to when I was 20, where he gave me some sense to know good and bad, and what I was doing was bad, and I didn't have anything of any good. So I moved to Indiana and I meet my wife. We're married, we have children. God's not the center. Life is okay, but we end up getting divorced. I kind of was disgusted in myself for the situation that had happened, of course, because I was in the driver's seat, and everything you try to do, it's always gonna fall short. And so my marriage fell short. I was just gonna leave Indiana, and my wife was like, I've been going to church. Would you want to go to church with me? It was a couple days later, Sunday rolls around, I go to church, and I haven't stopped going. Shortly after that, we got remarried. This young pastor comes about, and he's bringing the word. He's bringing scripture to life for me. God is using him through the word, and it's coming at me like none other. I'm getting this full understanding. It's scripture and life. God used him, and the fire just grew within me to wanting to know and gain more understanding. And as I start seeking more knowledge about the word, about God and life, and applying Bible to life, things just started to happen. I ended up getting baptized. I absolutely went 100% after God, after Jesus. I needed to know, how could he just love you so much after all that you've done? You're washed clean. I need to know that love. And I went chasing, and little bits at a time, he just give it to you. Just give it to you. And then more things happening, more blessings. And then I see the growth in my kids, and I see the growth in myself, and God's just using my family, using us, and blessing us, and able to bless others. My children have grown up, they know God. 100%, I believe that. My wife and I are closer than we've ever been. Financially, we've been blessed more than I thought we would ever be. Which allows us to give more than we thought we could ever give. And with that, God's grace has just flooded me with more than I thought I would ever have. If you have that thirst or that hunger or wanting to know, if you just keep asking those questions and keep going after God, He will reveal Himself.
As we respond to practical teaching, our obedience causes our faith to grow deeper. And so what I want to ask you to do this morning is I want you to look in your worship folder. There's a line there where it says next step. And you know, we may not put that in there every week, but we're thinking in that direction, and I hope you're thinking in that direction yourself. Make it simple. Just say, so what? I'm okay with that. Every Sunday when you come in here and we sing these songs that have words with such meaning, and then you hear a message that is presented toward application, and you hear the truth of God's word, when it's all said and done, so what? What difference is it going to make? What are you going to do about it? That's the question. And so as we continue on in our worship this morning, we're going to sing together, and as we do, I want to invite you to ask the Lord to show you today, what does that mean for you? What's my next step? So what? What am I going to do about it? I sat here for a few minutes. I've listened, I've sang, I've heard, and now what? Let the Lord speak to you as we worship together.